we delay this further, it could be happy hour.
It already is.
In Malta, it's definitely happy hour. We'll wait one moment for... good afternoon and welcome to the Department of State. As was just announced in the White House press briefing, given current security conditions in Libya, coupled with our inability to guarantee fully the safety and security of our diplomatic personnel in the country, the Department of State has temporarily withdrawn embassy personnel from Tripoli and suspended all embassy operations effective today. You know, the safety of the American community remains paramount to the department, and we will continue to provide assistance to the greatest extent possible, you know, through other missions. And today we were gratified that the ferry was able to depart, you know, Libya and has arrived in Valletta, you know, Malta, as well as the departure from Tripoli of one last charter that carried our remaining diplomatic personnel from the mission, as well as other American citizens and third country nationals. But two of the hardest working people through the last several days, actually probably the last several weeks, are Undersecretary for Management Pat Kennedy and Deputy Assistant Secretary Janet Sanderson from our NEA Bureau. We thought we'd bring them down just to kind of you know, review what it means now to have our operations in Libya suspended. We still have diplomatic relations with Libya, and we'll continue to you know, discuss ongoing events with the Libyan leadership. But to go through a few of the mechanics of how we got to this point, you know, obviously, you know, Pat has been central in terms of the logistics of moving American citizens out of harm's way. You know, Janet has been involved in all of the interagency meetings and conversing every day with our DCM, who's done a brilliant job. Our chargé has done a brilliant job in Tripoli. But, you know, Pat, Janet, thanks for coming down.
Thank you. As you may be aware, one of the major responsibilities of the State Department is to ensure assistance to American citizens, if at all possible. Since the 15th of February, we've issued over 10 warning notices of various kinds to American citizens, and starting on the 20th, we announced to the community that we had authorized the departure of family members, and then on the 21st, we increased that by ordering the departure of all family members and non-emergency personnel. A number of American citizens have departed via commercial means or via charters arranged by their companies or via assistance, mutual assistance, so to speak, provided by other governments. Even though flights were operating, the airport was somewhat chaotic with large numbers of people there, and therefore the U.S. Moved and put a chartered ferry boat with a 600-person capacity into the port on Wednesday morning. During the course of the day on Wednesday, we loaded about 250, 270 people, about half American, half third country nationals. We had planned to sail from the port that evening. There were 15 to 18-foot waves, which made sailing unsafe, and so we held the ferry over yesterday, and the waves did not abate, and we loaded about another dozen or so individuals onto the ferry yesterday, and again planning to sail last night, again could not. Finally, after long consultations with U.S. Armed Forces weather experts, we knew that the weather would break probably this morning. And so, again, loaded another few people onto the ferry who presented themselves this morning, and the ferry departed. At the same time, we also announced yesterday to the American community that we would be making a charter aircraft available today. We brought the charter aircraft in, loaded the remaining official American employees on it, and about another dozen or so American citizens and a number of third country nationals as well. And that aircraft has now departed. As PJ has said, we have now suspended operations of the embassy. Again, as PJ has said, that does not mean that diplomatic relations are broken. We will continue to carry on work with the government of Libya, and Janet can address that in more detail. But essentially, we have moved to get out as many American citizens as we could and who presented themselves to the embassy. We will continue to work to assist American citizens. The Bureau of Consular Affairs has a 7 by 24 hour by 365 day a week capability. If any additional American citizens are in need of assistance, they can contact, or their family members or others can contact the State Department, and we will see what we can do. But we have put in, as I said, the last charter flight that we intend to at this time, and we do know that the airport, in spite of it being overcrowded, still is moving some commercial planes in and out. Janet?
Thank you, Pat. In addition to the responsibilities we have to the American community and to our own mission on the ground, obviously one of the things that the department has been doing in the last week to 10 days is a full court press in terms of trying to develop a set of options for the president and for his decision makers with regard to the continuing and indeed intensifying violence on the ground, violence against the Libyan people, and what seems to us to be increasing problems with the regime and with the way it is handling its governance of the country. You've seen, of course, that the Secretary of State has made a number of calls to her counterparts around the world in the last couple of days. Those calls are continuing. She has consulted with African foreign ministers, European foreign ministers, and others who are interested in the fate of Libya. Secretary has echoed what the President has said. We're shocked and appalled by what we have seen on the ground in Libya. We hold the Libyan government accountable for its actions and the actions of its military and other security forces as these atrocities are being perpetrated. We are deeply concerned about the fate of the Libyan people, and we are looking at a variety of options, a toolkit, if you will, in addition to sanctions, unilateral, the ones that were announced this morning, or this afternoon, rather, by the White House, but in conjunction with our friends and like-minded allies in the area. We're looking at other options, and of course there is the multilateral track. I don't have a lot of details for you right now. We are having those consultations. They're ongoing. But I think the important thing to take away is that the international community is speaking with one voice about what is happening in Libya. We are all concerned and shocked. And we are looking at ways to try and not only change the behavior of the government, but also hold it accountable for what is happening on the ground. The Secretary will go to the Human Rights Council meeting in Geneva on Sunday, I think she departs. The meeting is on Monday. And the President dispatched Undersecretary for Political Affairs Bill Burns to Europe. He is now there for consultations with some of our closest European allies about what's next. Obviously, let me say something about the state of diplomatic relations between the United States and Libya. Let me underscore what Pat has said. Our embassy is not closed. We have suspended operations. We still continue to reach out to the Libyans where appropriate, both directly and through third parties. The Libyan embassy here is up and running. We have not been informed in any change of the status of the ambassador. I will be meeting with representatives of the Libyan embassy shortly after this meeting to convey our decision about the suspension of diplomatic activities of our mission on the ground in Libya. But the relationship remains, and we do have channels of communication to speak directly to the Libyan government about the very grave concern we have about the evolving situation on the ground. Thank you.
A couple things logistically. One, when the flight, in terms of the embassy being temporarily closed, does that mean that they took the flag with them, the last people out, or is that still
no.
up and running?
No, the
up and flying, rather?
Yes, the flag. The flag is still flying. All right. The embassy is not closed. Operations are suspended. Right. Okay. Relations are not broken.
How many official Americans were on that plane the last one out?
There were 19 official Americans on the plane.
And about a dozen private, you said?
About a dozen private American citizens and nine foreign nationals. Right.
13
and
then, to be exact.
13.
So 41 okay. total on the
41.
And then the last thing, and who is the protecting power? Who has agreed to be the protecting power?
That is still being worked out.
So that there is no protecting power yet?
There's no protecting power has yet been named.
Who have you approached?
That's a matter for diplomatic. That's a matter for diplomatic discussions, Matt, and we'll be back to you on that one.
What country are you aware of that intend to keep their embassies open in this fluid situation?
In a fluid situation, we will give you an answer when we have one.
All right. So right now, you can't advise Americans who are still in Libya. There's no one that you can tell to go to now.
They can contact the State Department via email. They can contact the State Department via phone, and the Bureau of Consular Affairs will do what it can to assist them.
Okay. Thank you.
Why are you not suspending relations? Diplomatic relations with Libya, wouldn't that be a far stronger sign?
Well, as I think the Secretary and the President have said, we're looking at a range of options as we try and figure out a way to deal with this situation. I mean, obviously everything is on the table, as the President said, so I don't want to prejudge what's going to happen down the road. But at this point, we felt it was most appropriate to suspend operations.
Michelle, what was the main concern that pushed the State Department to evacuate all the officials from Tripoli?
I think the situation, the chaos in the streets, the gunfire at night, beginning in the last couple of days, even gunfire during the day. We will execute always due prudence when we engage in diplomatic activities. We're there to represent the United States. We're there to advance our economic interest. We're there to assist and protect American citizens. But when the situation becomes significantly insecure, it is at that point prudent to continue our diplomatic activities with a country via other means.
Can I ask whether there is anybody left at that embassy, any sort of security personnel, anything like that, and also whether there were any notifications provided to the Libyans prior to everybody leaving the country? I had heard there might have been something yesterday. I don't know if that was true or not.
We have our locally engaged staff is still on duty at our compound.
Sorry, what is that? Non-diplomatic speak, locally engaged staff. What do you mean?
Our Libyan employees are still. We're still on. We did not break diplomatic relations. Our Libyan employees are still on the payroll and are still at the working at the Chancery.
Okay. And are there any sort of any American security personnel?
No. There are no. All American official employees were withdrawn today.
Okay. And then on the notification question, whether there was anything done yesterday.
Undersecretary Burns had a conversation with the Libyan foreign minister this morning where Mr. Burns shared this information with him. And as I said, I'm going to be meeting with a representative of the Libyan embassy this afternoon to formally give them the diplomatic note.
The Libyan employees that are still working, are any of them security?
Yes. I mean, we have both local national security guards and employees, Libyan employees who work in other sections of the embassy.
Okay, and then also, how are you aware of any American citizens that are still in Libya trying to get out who have contacted you? I mean, at this point, are you saying that you've gotten out all of the Americans who were there who needed help getting out?
No, we can never say that. As you know, or maybe you don't know, there is no requirement that an American citizen register at an embassy when he or she travels. It's free travel. We certainly encourage American citizens to register at an embassy, and the multiple warning notices, the 10 that we put out since the 15th of February, have encouraged individuals to register. But many of those individuals may have left on commercial flights. They may have left on flights. We know of at least one who left on a Dutch flight. A number of other Americans left on a British warship out of Benghazi. And so since we don't have that kind of travel control on American citizens, I can't say we started with X and these many left and these many therefore are remaining behind. But But as we said earlier, if American citizens are in need of assistance, there is material that how they can reach us both via telephone and on the website.
And then if I could ask you one more, given how difficult it was, I know it was largely weather, but given how difficult it was to get Americans out of Libya, in retrospect, would you have ordered a departure earlier than you did, earlier than the 21st?
No, I don't believe so. The situation, we measure the situation on the ground very, very carefully. We consider our ability to continue to operate fully, and then as the situation deteriorates, it is a multi-stage process. You first potentially go to an authorized departure for family members, and then you authorize the departure of non-emergency personnel. We jumped that step and went to the ordered departure of all family members and non-emergency personnel. So we each situation is calibrated against the political environment, the security environment, and U.S. national interest.
There has been some criticism because here we had this ferry that was stuck there for 3 days because of weather problems, and yet the British and some other countries apparently were able to evacuate their citizens while our American citizens were trapped aboard that ferry. So was this a case where we didn't have the assets in place that we needed, or we caught short, or what was the issue?
I don't think so. For example, a Canadian aircraft went in today and left empty because of the chaos at the airport. We sent the ferry in deliberately because we gauged starting on Tuesday that the situation at the airport was becoming sufficiently chaotic that we were worried about moving people through the airport. Therefore, we decided to use another means of transportation, having excluded overland transportation to the west. We thought because the ferry terminal is a different location, it was a little bit easier to obtain space there. We had cooperation from the government of Libya in doing that, so we put the ferry in with every intention of taking it out. The weather turned bad. I wouldn't describe the people as trapped on the ferry boat. This is not a ferry boat like the Staten Island ferry. It is a Mediterranean ferry with enclosed cabins, food, shelter, and restroom facilities. Would I have liked it to be able to sail that first day? Absolutely. When we send an evacuation ship in, we send it in to get people out. But the determination was made that the weather was unsafe, and so we decided to hold the ferry till the weather cleared.
Having grown up on Staten Island, I will bypass the slander that you just committed.
Having lived in New York for 4 years, I've also traveled on the Staten Island ferry.
But, the RAF got in and out, didn't they?
The RAF got in and out, and the Canadians got a plane in, and were not able to get anyone loaded.
All the Americans on the ferry are safe in Malta, right? Nothing bad happened to them while they were stuck for however many hours.
That's correct.
So, all right. So I just don't understand what the problem is.
But, sorry.
Can I just ask?
Without stepping on the Pentagon's toes, we also had some military assets over the horizon that if the situation was concerning in any way, we had options available. But as Pat said, we did get cooperation from every element of this operation except for the weather. And we did not feel at any time that the people on the ferry were in any other danger than anyone who is currently in Tripoli at the moment.
And can you just say when your coordination with military, the United States military, and those assets began, if we can say that the crisis
from the moment that we've had high-level meetings on the situation in Libya, the military has been fully involved in this process. So the coordination has been true of Egypt, true of Bahrain, true of Libya, and
Tunisia.
This is how we function as a government.
When it was that the decision to suspend operations was made, was it yesterday after Gaddafi's rant?
Well, Pat, this is something that we have been evaluating, you know.
But at some point, someone had to sign off on something.
Well, I think this had been the recommendation of these experts. But the real question was, today was the day where all the pieces, you know, fell into place, where we were able to move the ferry out. We weren't going to take this action as long as the ferry was there. We got permission today to bring the.
I understand that. The trigger is where the ferry and the plane leaving. I understand. When was the decision made that once those triggers were, that those were going to be the triggers for the closure of the embassy, well, or the suspension of operation?
I mean, that decision was made today based on the fact that we could actually accomplish.
But you had to know at some point beforehand that you were going to. You had to tell your diplomats who are remaining in Libya, get to this plane because we're going to.
Something that has been a daily conversation.
When was that decision
made? You know, throughout this.
When was the decision made for all those diplomats to show up at the airfield to get on this plane?
Today.
That was made this morning.
Well, we put the plans in place before today, but we gave the decision to execute today.
I understand that, but when was the. Are you trying to tell me that the decision to close, the decision to shut down the embassy was made when the White House announced it? No.
No, I mean.
When was it made?
This decision to shut down was made when we were sure that we could get all official Americans out and as many American citizens as we were able to assemble and transport.
Because if Bill Burns talked to Musa Kusa this morning to tell him, obviously the decision was made before perhaps the plane even landed or perhaps the ferry even left. So
right.
When was the decision made? Was it yesterday? Was it last night? Was it overnight? Was it?
I don't want to parse things, but I think we could say the decision was made yesterday that should all the pieces fall into place, we would move today.
All right,
if all the pieces hadn't fallen into place today, we might have moved tomorrow.
Okay, understood.
Or if the situation had all of a sudden reversed itself.
Right, it never would have been made.
It never would have been made.
I understand. Just answered my question. But was that, when you decided that if all the pieces fell into place, was that after Gaddafi's speech?
Thank you. Actually, I don't know. I don't know that was a factor. I think we were just looked at the totality of the situation and made the decision.
And who made the decision?
Decisions like that are made by the to withdraw personnel or made by the Secretary of State.
When do you expect to resume operations in the embassy?
We would resume American operation at the embassy when the security situation permits it.
Can I ask about remaining pockets of Americans who may be outside of Tripoli, for example, who may want to leave? I understand that there were some that have been identified in oil installations, for example, other parts of the country. Can you give us a sense of the size of those pockets and how they plan on leaving?
We've been in contact. Our task force, which has a heavy component from the Bureau of Consular Affairs, Office of Citizen Services, we're in contact with the oil company and other businesses. The Bureau of Diplomatic Security has the Overseas Security Advisory Council, which is also a part of this effort. So we're in contact with the American companies we know to be there, and American companies we didn't know to be there are in contact with us, and many of them are making arrangements to reach those pockets of individuals, some of whom were brought into Tripoli and subsequently have left. Others were brought into Benghazi, including a number of them who left on a British naval vessel late yesterday.
Okay, I just want to follow up real quick. Of the ones that are left, I mean, can you give us a sense of how many you're talking about?
Well,
these dozens, hundreds of this.
Perhaps if I could elaborate on that answer. We have a task force that's worked very closely with similar task forces in capitals around the world. And between us and our friends, particularly in Europe, we've been able to sort of trade off, for want of a better term. So actually, a number of the people in the oil fields that we'd identified over the last 96 hours have either moved and got on the charter today, or more likely were evacuated out by their companies who could get flights in, or by friendly nations who have offered us seats.
According to the last thing the task force told me, and we can certainly check and make sure that's correct, they believe that there are no significant pockets of Americans in the oil fields that we have identified. Let me be honest, there may be others out there that we have not been able to contact or that decide for whatever reason they would like to shelter in place for the time being. But to the best of our knowledge, the major groups of people that we were working about 3 to 4 days ago have now moved on, but we're in the process of confirming that.
And how many were those? I mean, just to give us a sense.
Oh, I don't remember how many. I think we heard, you know, there were 6 here and there were 4 here and there were 5 here. We do know that at least 2 of the major oil companies were able to get their own charters in and did evacuations in the last 24 to 36 hours. So we'll have to get back to you on that.
Thanks.
Do you have any sense of how many Americans have evacuated? I know this is a tough question. How many Americans have been evacuated? How many is there any way we can couch, you know, how many Americans were?
I think that we could say that there were about 200 private American citizens taken out by our means, but many other American citizens left commercially and left on company charters or on via Dutch or British means, just as we, in sort of in a mutual assistance pact, brought out nationals of other nations as well, both on the ferry and on the chartered aircraft today.
Sure. Just one clarification about the security. You said that there are no U.S. security people in place. What measures are being taken to secure communications, documents, et cetera, inside that embassy?
I'm not going to go into our processes on security, but I can assure you that there is nothing left behind that could be compromised.
And just one clarification on the locally employed staff. I mean, they're still working, like the guards are still there, I understood, but they're not authorized to do any business of the U.S. government with the Libyan government, correct?
Unless instructed by us.
And they're not issuing visas or anything like that. So essentially, the embassy is closed for business. I realize you don't want to use the word closed.
Operations are suspended, and those activities that only could be carried out by American personnel are suspended.
The spokesman at the White House used the word shuttered. Would you agree?
Of course.
Yeah. There you go.
The door is locked.
Did Secretary Clinton have to sign a document for this order to take effect? It was issued verbally, her order.
She did not. She does not have to sign a document.
And has the Libyan government said to you how it will deal with this embassy right now? Have they given any assurances that it will remain intact, untouched by them?
Undersecretary Burns had a very brief conversation with the foreign minister this morning, and we didn't go into details on that. I'll take the opportunity of my meeting this afternoon with the Libyan embassy to put down some markers with regard to the maintenance and protection of our embassy facilities.
Just on that, I mean, you said that you had not been notified of any change in the ambassador's status.
That's correct.
Well, he seems to have been doing his own notifying. Obviously,
I don't want to speak for the ambassador.
What is it? Your understanding that he represents the government of Libya as led by Colonel Gaddafi?
We have nothing to the contrary at this point.
Well, I mean, if you could, if it is in fact true that he has resigned as he says he has. You can tell him all you want that you want your embassy to be protected, but it isn't going to do
anything.
That's
true. That's true. But he hasn't informed us that he's resigned.
So you're operating on the assumption that he still represents the government.
Until we have been told either by him or by the Libyan government otherwise.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Get some rest.
Just to touch on a couple of things related to Libya, then we can move on to any other subjects you have. Just to go through some specific numbers. On the airplane today, there were 41 passengers, the remaining 19 official party, 13 other American citizens, and 9 citizens of other countries. And on the ferry, there were 338 passengers, including 183 American citizens, and that would include the 40 official Americans or that might be technically not correct. It might be 39. We took one passenger. So I think, you know, including the 39 official party, we took one passenger off the ferry this morning, and she has been transported to Italy via an Italian evacuation. She is 8.5 months pregnant, and 155 citizens of other countries.
Included the 40?
Oh, sorry. It's, pardon me?
The 183 included?
Includes the 39, yes.
Okay. And then what was the total for the international?
If my math is correct, it would be 183, 155 equals 338.
So there were more international people on this than private American citizens?
No, 183 Americans.
Oh, but
Yeah.
Private.
But, yeah. Okay.
Did you take any other official foreign members from other embassies and that kind of thing? Do you know?
Yes.
You did.
I don't have a breakout of that, but yes, there were members of the official party of our other embassies too.
What kind of plane was that charter?
I don't know.
Was on that charter, right?
The Chargé was on the charter.
Was it a military?
It took off from Mitiga. The military airfield?
Because there had been reports unconfirmed that had fallen to the opposition. Is that correct?
No. As far as I know, it didn't. Those reports were not correct.
Was this plane a military plane?
No, it was a commercial charter.
Commercial, and so chartered in Istanbul?
In Istanbul, and is perhaps still in the air or has at land. I don't know. Just to kind of recap, with the UN Human Rights Council session today, it did adopt by consensus a resolution that condemned the gross and systematic violations of human rights by the government of Libya, established an independent international commission of inquiry to investigate these violations and to make recommendations on accountability measures for those responsible, and recommended that the UN General Assembly consider the suspension of Libya's membership on the council given these violations. The actual suspension of Libya's council membership will be considered by the General Assembly next week, probably on Tuesday, and we are already working with our partners regarding this issue. And just to clarify, I know we had a question of whether expulsion versus suspension was the correct term. It is, in fact, suspension. And this would be the first time a council member has been suspended since the council was founded in 2006.
Well, 2000, that's not that long.
It's not that long, yeah. So,
how about maybe you could go back to when it was the commission, and that might be a little bit more revealing.
But just to touch on briefly, Deputy Secretary Jim Steinberg held meetings earlier today in Tirana, Albania, with Prime Minister Salih Berisha, President Bamir Topi, and other senior officials. And in Sarajevo today, he met with members of the Tri-Presidency and other political leaders, where he urged all parties to conclude formation of a government. During the previous 2 days, he had visits to Armenia, Georgia, and Azerbaijan, where he met with Presidents Sarkisian of Armenia, Saakashvili of Georgia, and President Aliyev of Azerbaijan. And next week, Undersecretary Maria Ortero will be in Nigeria to discuss the promotion of democratic institutions and processes as Nigeria continues to work towards an important election.
This whole lack of a protecting power, it seems a bit unusual that you would shut down, suspend the operations of the embassy without having a protecting power lined up. I know that in the two other cases where you have protecting powers, things were different. It took a while to get the Swiss on board in Iran because things happened so quickly, but. Can you explain why the decision was made to go ahead and suspend operations if you didn't have someone lined up to take over?
The situation on the ground, was the reason for that. And I think Pat hinted at it, which is we are still sorting out with other countries what their
Who's going to stay?
What their plans are as well. So, we will be working to establish a protecting power, but given the uncertainty of the situation, those conversations are ongoing.
PJ.
James.
Is the United States government in contact at all with any part of the opposition in Libya?
I can't say that we, the United States, have had any contact with the opposition at this point. We have had discussions with other leaders who have been in touch with opposition figures to try to understand what is happening on the ground.
What other leaders are those?
I'm not going to catalog. I can go back over the discussions that the secretary has had today. She talked to Foreign Minister Lawrence Cannon of Canada. She also talked to Tony Blair, yesterday she talked to AU chairperson President Ping. So we are. Pardon me.
Or Tony Blair.
Tony Blair.
Why would she speak about Libya?
Yes.
All right, so are you suggesting that some of these individuals have had contact with the opposition?
Well, she talked yesterday with the Chadian president, and these are collectively figures who have far closer contacts and broader ties, or let me reverse that, closer ties and broader contacts than we do. So we are talking to a wide range of people, trying to our best to get understand fully what is actually happening on the ground.
Should it be a source of concern that we have no direct contact with the opposition in Libya?
I mean, this is still an unfolding situation, James. So I'm not going to rule out that at some point we may well reach out to other figures in Libyan society. In fact, I suspect that we will. But I can't tell you that any direct discussions have occurred at this point.
PJ, in Jay Carney's briefing, he said that the U.S. is going to use the full extent of intelligence capabilities to monitor Gaddafi. Now, presumably, the U.S. is already doing that. But it seemed to be a shot over the bow to Gaddafi. We're watching you. But what
Absolutely.
Would the U.S. do? Well, is it?
Well,
and then also,
obviously,
in
terms of our pledge to hold Mr. Gaddafi, his family, his regime, fully accountable for what is happening on the ground, we will have to to build a case. Now, there has been a meeting in the UN today to assess what is actually known. So we will be watching very closely, intensively, to see what's happening on the ground and. As part of our efforts, not only to understand and to the extent that we can, shape future decisions, but also to hold the Libyan government responsible for the actions that it has taken and will take.
And PJ, in exactly with that point, I was looking at this statement, this speech by Biden at the Holocaust Museum, in which he referred to something you said a while ago: when a state engages in atrocity, it forfeits its sovereignty. I mean, is the U.S. now preparing to make a case that because of this violence and atrocity that the Libyan government has forfeited its sovereignty, therefore action could be taken internationally?
Well, I certainly think, as Jay Carney said in his briefing today, that the legitimacy of the Libyan government is basically gone based on its turning its weapons against its own people. Going forward, obviously, we will look for ways to support the Libyan people. We are looking, for example, at and studying the humanitarian situation on the ground, and that will be something that we'll be focused on in the coming days. Our broad message to Libya today, just as it has been, throughout this period, is to stop the violence, stop the bloodshed. And we will continue to find ways to communicate that, to the Libyan officials.
You just said build a case. It sounds like a warning to Libyan officials that they might find themselves before the ICC or something of that nature.
Well, again, part of what the Human Rights Council did today was to establish an independent international commission of inquiry. We will do our best to contribute to, gathering, the facts and evidence of what has happened in Libya, and those facts will determine what the appropriate steps are.
An investigation for the, that leads to an ICC prosecution.
Again, let's not jump ahead. As you yourselves have, which you are not a member of,
and have taken great pains to to make clear that you're not a member of the successive administration. So I'm just wondering if, or are you looking at? I mean, when are you looking at having an ad hoc tribunal?
As I was trying to say, you're leaping ahead of the process. We will be gathering facts as an international community about what has happened in Libya and the responsibility of the government, for the violence and violations of human rights that have occurred. Once we have a consensus on what has occurred and who is responsible, then. The international community, working through the UN, will determine next steps.
But PJ, just to really push it beyond where you want to go, is it conceivable that, I mean, looking again at what you're hinting here, that the international community, that the U.S. could be looking at the possibility of working with the international community to launch some type of concerted, shall we say, military action to go into Libya and protect those people in spite of Gaddafi because he has given up his sovereignty?
Well, as we have said, we have developed for the president and the senior leaders of this government a range of options. We are concerned about the humanitarian situation on the ground, and that will be one of a number of areas that we focus on in coming days. As we've said, the military is a full participant in the policy development process that is going on, and we have not ruled out any option at this point.
PJ, your comments reflect the fact that the United States has made a determination that the Gaddafi regime or the Libyan government has lost legitimacy, as you have put it. Have you also made a determination about the actual degree of control that Gaddafi maintains over his territory?
Well, that is something that one of the reasons why we highlighted that we are devoting increasing attention and intelligence assets, without getting into particular intelligence matters, to fully understand what is going on. It is clear that Gaddafi and the Libyan government do not control major swaths of the country at this point.
What about Tripoli? What's your assessment as to his extent of control of the city?
At this point, I believe that the situation in Tripoli differs somewhat from the situation in other parts of the country. But there is obviously a very fluid situation. So I don't know that I can do a current play-by-play, but.
I won't ask you to redistrict Tripoli for me, but I'm just saying, does he appear to be in control of the majority of the city?
That's a hard judgment for you to make from here.
Well, if it's so different from the rest of the country, why would
the situation in Tripoli today was described as relatively stable in the city itself. Obviously, we were able to get some citizens to the airfield to depart. We were able to get some citizens to the dock to join others who are on board the ferry. So there is the ability to function, in Tripoli itself. I can't speak for, how far outside of Tripoli does that situation change dramatically. But it's clear that the government no longer has control of major population centers, in the country besides Tripoli.
We move on.
Sure.
Someone else?
Do you think the security concerns of the American personnel that were on post there? Did you also have as a rationale for your decision to evacuate some sort of nod to the demonstrators to say essentially we can't also tolerate the indiscriminate shooting of civilians?
Well, I don't see those as being mutually exclusive. You know, the decision to suspend operations at the embassy, as Pat Kennedy was saying, was about one, our concern about the security situation and the welfare of American diplomats there. The fact that, as far as we could tell, we had successfully evacuated as many American citizens as had identified themselves, you know, to us. And three, you know, given a chaotic situation from a practical standpoint, what else could our embassy accomplish on the ground? We do maintain diplomatic relations so that we can continue to try to understand what is going on, and to the extent that we can, working with others in the national community, try to influence future decisions by the Libyan government. But that is something that we can do, obviously, from outside of the country, mm-hmm. Pakistan.
More on Libya? I'm sorry.
Yeah. Okay.
The one thing that no one has said, now that that all the Americans are out, you know, the U.S. continues to condemn the violence, but nobody's calling for Colonel Gaddafi to step down yet. Why is that?
Well, this is a situation that continues to unfold. Ultimately, as we have said, who leads Libya in the future is not for the United States to determine.
But I'm not asking you to determine.
I understand that. We are consulting broadly with others in the international community about how we assess the situation, on the ground. That is an issue that we continue to analyze.
But just to be clear,
you say that he's lost his legitimacy. So that would suggest that the United States believes that he is
ultimately,
beyond redemption.
Ultimately,
here, that
you know,
he cannot stay on as.
But that will ultimately be determined inside Libya, not from outside Libya.
Yeah, but your determination.
I'm not as far as I'm prepared to go.
Acknowledge him as the leader of Libya at this point, the United States?
I believe from a legal standpoint, he is still the head of state and head of government. But clearly he has lost legitimacy in the eyes of his people, and that obviously influences our perceptions of him as well.
And he's lost legitimacy in the eyes of the United States too as well?
Yes.
Can you check to see if he actually is the... is head of government. He's got some bizarre title. I'm not sure that's what it is. Anyway.
I'm shocked to hear that.
Move on.
Pakistan.
Sorry. Why exactly did she call Blair about Libya? Because of his dealings with Gaddafi over the Lockerbie bombing?
He has very important, valuable contacts inside of Libya.
And use those contacts to... to assist the United States or to do
things in the past
that the United States wanted?
I'm not Tony Blair's spokesperson. He actually has an able spokesperson.
Okay, so what do we know anything more about the American who was detained today in Peshawar, first of all? And then I want to ask you about the second American in Lahore, his parents. Aaron Mark DeHaven, I believe is what the statement said.
I'm staring at a statement by the, that came out of, Pakistan today. We've seen reports that Aaron Mark DeHaven has been detained by police in Peshawar, and we are arranging, consular access through the government of Pakistan.
So you don't know anything more about him? Why he was
arrested? All we know.
What about the other American who had the court appearance?
I don't know that we have had consular access yet, so I don't think that we're questioning the report that there is an American in detention in Peshawar, but beyond that, it's hard for us to know exactly what the circumstances are.
And you have no reason to understand why he's been detained or whether it's connected to the other case of a detention?
I would not suggest that it's connected to the other case.
And about the other case, what is your understanding of what happened today in court?
Well, Mr. Davis was in court today. My understanding is in court today, he presented the court with a copy of a diplomatic note that affirms his full immunity from criminal prosecution. The court received that document and indicated that it would take the matter under consideration, and I believe there's another hearing scheduled for March 3rd.
He presented the court with a diplomatic note from who? From the U.S. government?
He presented a copy of a diplomatic note that was presented to the government of Pakistan.
Isn't
by the United
kind
States
of like
government.
Presenting a note from your mother that says, you know,
well,
I mean, what,
I, he, I mean,
if the Pakistan, I mean, presenting this diplomatic note, how does that? I mean, that note has been presented to the Pakistani government already.
Right, but we wanted to put that note before the court as well.
And he declined the offer of an attorney. Is that correct, or has refused to hire an attorney?
I can't comment on. I mean, he does have. You know, legal representation by Pakistani, you know, lawyers.
He does.
I can't speak to their you know, particular status. We had consular officials present at today's hearing.
And PJ, that note—that's the original note that he had when he went into the country.
My understanding, it was a note that we provided to Pakistan, the government, earlier this month.
Oh, earlier this month. So.
I asked that question. It was not the original note from last year.
So wait, you presented earlier this month. It wasn't a new note.
No,
it was just a copy.
It was a copy of a note that we had already presented to the government of Pakistan, but we presented to the court in Lahore.
So that's the one you presented initially, a copy of the one from January 20th, right?
Thank you.
Have a nice weekend.
Thank you.